Зоны влияния существуют прежде всего благодаря той политике, которую колониальные державы проводили. И когда состоялась деколонизация, им очень не хотелось эти зоны влияния терять. И были выдуманы самые разные способы, как удержать эти территории. Так что мы видим, как эти зоны осваиваются по-прежнему. И как новые территории пытаются втянуть в зоны влияния наших западных коллег. Я откровенно сегодня говорил на переговорах с Энтони Блинкеном об этом. И печально, что взрослые люди занимаются вот таким контестом, кто круче, у кого больше не знаю чего. Если бы мы все по-взрослому подумали о том, как нам жить в современном мире, чтобы он был безопасен с точки зрения происходящих изменений климата, с точки зрения других глобальных угроз, и терроризма, и наркотрафик, и здоровья людей, которые подвергаются жутким опасностям в связи с пандемией, говорят, это далеко не последняя пандемия. Вот чем надо заниматься. А вместо этого мы занимаемся тем, что вот все сводится в российско-американских отношениях к тому, как себя чувствует Зеленский и его, значит, режим. Неправильно это. Мы не претендуем на зоны влияния, но то, что делает сейчас НАТО по отношению к Украине, однозначно показывает, что НАТО рассматривает Украину как свою зону своего влияния.
Tensions are increasing. Russia continues its military build-up, and we see also more troops not only in and around Ukraine, but also now in Belarus. This takes place under the disguise of an exercise, but it integrates very much the Russian forces and the Belarusian forces, and these are highly capable combat-ready troops, and there is no transparency on these deployments. It shows that there is no de-escalation. On the contrary, it's actually more troops, more capabilities in more countries. A political solution is still possible. But then, of course, Russia has to engage in good faith. We have made our proposals. We are ready to listen to also the Russian concerns and engage in reciprocal efforts to find a way forward.
Russia had previously outlined its concerns and proposals in writing, and last week I told Foreign Minister Lavrov that the United States would do the same. Today, Ambassador Sullivan delivered our written response in Moscow. All told, it sets out a serious diplomatic path forward, should Russia choose it. The document we've delivered includes concerns of the United States and our allies and partners about Russia's actions that undermine security, a principled and pragmatic evaluation of the concerns that Russia has raised, and our own proposals for areas where we may be able to find common ground. We make clear that there are core principles that we are committed to uphold and defend, including Ukraine's sovereignty and territorial integrity, and the right of states to choose their own security arrangements and alliances. We've addressed the possibility of reciprocal transparency measures regarding force posture in Ukraine, as well as measures to increase confidence regarding military exercises and maneuvers in Europe. And we address other areas where we see potential for progress, including arms control related to missiles in Europe, our interest in a follow-on agreement to the New START treaty that covers all nuclear weapons, and ways to increase transparency and stability.
Minister asked me, what do you think what Russia really wants? And how did this just on the other side of the street? Is Russia really interested to have a small tiny strip of Ukraine soil integrated in their country? No, this is nonsense. I think Putin is probably putting pressure on it because he can do it. He knows if he splits the European Union. But what he really wants is respect. He wants, on eye level, he wants respect. And my God, giving someone respect is low cost, even no cost. So if I was asked, it is easy to even give him the respect he really demands and probably also deserves. Russia is an old country. Russia is an important country. Even we, India, Germany, we need Russia. The Crimea Peninsula is gone. They'll never come back. This is it. This is a fact. And we have to learn that political issues are factual questions and not emotions.
Eduardo, eu morei num quarto e cozinha com 13 pessoas. Então, eu tenho consciência do que esse povo está passando. Então, eu não posso mentir. Eu não posso ganhar os 76 anos e falar, gente, olha, eu ganhei, mas não dá para fazer as coisas. Desculpa, eu tenho que atender o mercado. Eu preciso atender a Faria Lima. Eu preciso ter responsabilidade fiscal. Eu preciso manter teto de gasto. E o teto de comida? E o teto de emprego? E o teto de salário? E o teto de saúde? Quem é que vai devolver para esse povo? Então, meu caro, é esse cidadão que acaba de ficar emocionado que quer ser presidente. E se for, é para mudar.
Utopia está lá no horizonte. Me aproximo dois passos, ela se afasta dois passos. Caminho 10 passos e o horizonte corre 10 passos. Por mais que eu caminhe, jamais alcançarei. Para que serve a utopia? Serve para isso, para que eu não deixe de caminhar. Eduardo Galeano.
Poderosos podem matar uma, duas ou três rosas, mas jamais conseguirão deter a chegada da primavera.
imágenes de lo que es el aniversario número 73 del líder del Partido de los Trabajadores, Luis Ignacio Lula da Silva. No se vayan a callar, que somos más.
Pode matar uma, duas ou três rodas, mas jamais conseguirão deter a chegada da primavera.
Compromisso de cuidar dos que mais precisam.
Todos vocês daqui pra frente vão virar Lula e vão andar.